Welcome to this webinar about judging the Friesian mare. My name is Sabine Swaga. I'm a KFVS inspector. In this webinar, which lasts about 45 to 60 minutes, I will take you with me in a nutshell regarding the assessment of the Friesian horse, in particular your mare. Because when you want to breed your mare, you need to know the qualities of your mare and also the points you want to improve in order to choose a suitable stallion for your mare. The starting point for the assessment of the Friesian horse is always the current breeding goal. And the breeding goal reflects the ideal image of the Friesian horse. The breeding goal is formulated by the breeding council in cooperation with the inspection and is determined by the member council. The KFBS breeding goal is described as follows: a functionally built utility horse possessing the Friesian breed characteristics that is healthy and vital, has the aptitude to perform in the sport, has reliable character and a good trainability. The breeding goal describes the breeding goal characteristics in more detail, and these characteristics are subdivided in four themes. One is the exterior, breeding type and the conformation and the leg work. Two is the aptitude for sports, in which the movement is included. Three is the character, and four is health and vitality. In this webinar, I will mainly focus on the first two themes, and in the end, I will also discuss the character. Let's go back to judging your mare. We always use a fixed order to assess the qualities of the Friesian horse. We first assess the breeding type, which is also called racial type or breed expression. Then we look at the conformation of the horse, the leg work and the movement. During the inspection in hand, we don't judge the character, but it is a very important component when you want to choose a stallion for your mare. So I also discuss this in this webinar. The typical breed characteristics distinguish the Friesian horse from other breeds. And what are those characteristics? The breeding goal says the following: a horse with an appearance that radiates class thanks to its impressive front, abundant feathers, black coat color, elegant outline and elevated paces. If we, this is what the Friesian horse makes so unique. And this is something we definitely want to preserve within the breed. For the assessment of breeding type, we inspect the following elements of the exterior. First the head, the neck, the feathers, the coat color and the elegance of outline. And in this picture, you see the ideal image, the ideal picture of a Friesian horse concerning the breeding characteristics. Long manes, yet black color, the socks, the tail, a very noble head, a vertical direction of the neck, and a long neck. So this comes close to the ideal image. Let's first start with the head. The breeding goal says we want to see a small, expressive, and noble head. The eyes are large and set wide apart. From the side, the nose has a slightly dished profile. The jaws are light and the ears are small with the tips slightly pointing at each other. Let's go to some pictures. Here you can see a horse with a very noble head. You can see large bright eyes. You can see that the nasal bone is somewhat dished. Large nostrils, a large mouth opening, light jaws. The ears could be a bit smaller maybe, but the points are the tips of the ears are pointing towards each other. So this is a very expressive head. And the head is very important for the appearance of a horse because it's the first thing you see when you enter a stable. Here I have two examples of less favorable heads. On the left you can see a horse with a convex nasal bone, also a long head, and the nostrils could be larger, the mouth opening is short, and small eyes. So not a lot of expression in this head. Also on the right side, the picture, It's a bit a coarse head with very, very small eyes. Also, the mouth opening could be longer. So this is not what we like to see for a Friesian horse. Then the second characteristic of breeding type, the neck. What do we want to see in the ideal picture? The neck and poll are long and together form a light upward arch. Neck conformation is vertical, very important. Seen from behind, the crest of the mane is straight. Okay, we go to the neck, the typical front of the Friesian horse. Besides the head, we look at the neck and we look at different aspects of the neck. First we look at the head-to-neck connection, then the length of the neck, the stance and the shape of the neck, and in the end to the crest of mane. I will discuss them all in the next couple of slides. We start with the head-to-neck connection. With this we mean the transition from the head to the neck. The head-to-neck connection and the length of the neck are both assessed in breeding type and also in conformation. When we look at the breeding type, the head-to-neck connection has to be light because it's more elegant than a heavy head-to-neck connection. When we assess the head-to-neck connection in the conformation, we look at functionality. What we want to see is a long poll, light jaws and room at the throat so that there is room for the glands here. If a horse has a light head-to-neck connection, it looks more elegant. This is another picture where you can see the head-to-neck connection. Also the distance between the back of the head and the throat, this distance has to be short. You can see the distance here is shorter than it is here. This is a heavy head-to-neck connection and this is a light head-to-neck connection. And we prefer this one. Then we go to the length of the neck. That is defined as the length between the back of the head to the withers or to the shoulder blade. And we prefer a long neck. Also, the length of the neck is also assessed in conformation. Then it's about functionality, and now it's just the appearance of the Friesian horse is nicer when the neck is long. The opposite way is a short neck. And this is almost the most important thing when assessing breeding type, the stance of the neck. What distinguishes the Friesian horse from other equine breeds is the vertical direction of the neck. It's so typical for the Friesian horse and it also makes the Friesian horse to look very proud. This is what we prefer. If you, on the right picture, you can see a horizontal neck. It's very functional when you want to use the horse in sports, but this kind of horse doesn't look as a Friesian anymore. And if the horse has a horizontal direction of the neck, the scores for breeding type will not be high. Then the shape of the neck. On the left, this is the ideal picture. Favorable stance of the neck. A lightly upward curved neck with good muscling of the top line of the neck and the neck rises high from the chest. This is what we like to see. A U-neck, in the second picture, is not elegant. This is very short length of the poll. It's an underneck and a vertical, very vertical direction of the neck. We don't like to see it and it also gives problems when using the horse. This is what I discussed before. A horizontal or a straight necks are all, neck are almost the same. This looks very nice, a swan neck, and this is what we used to like. We don't like it anymore because it gives some problems when you want a horse into the bit. With a swan neck, the highest point is the third cervical vertebrae instead of the poll. Here you can see that the poll is the highest point And here you can see the third vertebrae is the highest point. So that is what we call a swan neck. This is favorable, and the other things are less favorable. I have some pictures for you to explain. This is a horse with a very short neck. You can see from the backside of the head to the shoulder, it's very short, the length. Also the poll is very short, and the head-to-neck connection is heavy. This is a long neck, but it's a bulging neck. It has a lot of muscles here, an underneck. We like to see the muscles here in the top line, but not here in the underneck. This is an example of a horse, a Friesian horse, with a very horizontal direction of the neck. This is very rare, and if we had to judge this horse, I think he will score a 4 on breeding type and is not accepted in the stud book. That's because it really is too horizontal, and it's not characteristic anymore for a Friesian horse. The neck can also be too vertical, like the horse on the right. We prefer a vertical neck, but not too vertical. And the reason why we don't prefer that is a horse with a neck that's this vertical cannot use its back properly. These are two examples of the ewe neck. Of a short poll, an underneck, and a vertical direction in both. It's not nice to see, and it's also not functional. Yeah, the last characteristic of the neck is the crest of mane. The crest of mane should be a straight line when seen from behind, and we don't want to see a fallen crest. It's partly genetic, and we distinguish 3 degrees of a fallen crest. On the left, you see a C line. You can draw a C. So it's not a straight line, it's a C line. In the second picture, you can see an S line. And in the third picture, you can see a fallen crest. How do we take this into account? Depending on the age of a horse, of the mare, and the degree of the fallen crest, the inspection result is influenced negatively. For example, if you have a 4-year-old horse with an S line and she goes to an inspection for stud book acceptance, she can become star with the second premium in the maximum. The highest predicate is that she can receive. She cannot become star with the first premium or crown. If you have a 5-year-old horse with a fallen crest, she is not accepted in the stud book. So depending on the degree and the age, there's a maximum result for the inspection. Okay, we discussed the breeding type, the head and the neck. Now we go further with the feathers. And the Friesian horse has an abundant hair in mane, tail and socks. And here you can see that. We don't only look at the length of the feathers, but also the thickness of the feathers. The fourth characteristic is the coat color. The Friesian horse has a jet black coat color and ideal no white markings. This is a jet black color, but this is a stallion, and stallions have testosterone, and that's why their color is jet black. For mares, it's very difficult to keep them black. If you use them, or if they go in the fields, in the sunlight, if they sweat, they can easily turn a bit brownish. You can just go to the inspection when your horse is a bit brownish, and she can also become star or crown or something like that. Dyeing horses is prohibited. Then the markings. A Friesian horse has to be black. We only accept markings on the head, above the eye line, and with a maximum of 3 centimeters. This one is too big, I think. We have a specific coin to put on the marking and to see if it's too big or not. These are white hairs not accepted. The same is here and on the foot of the horse, on the pastern of the horse, white hairs, not accepted. Sometimes your horse has an injury and gets bites hairs because of the injury. Then you need a statement of your vet, historically documented, to take with you to the curing, to the inspection. Then the last aspect of the breeding type, we focused on the head and the front of the horse. And besides the color and the feathers, we also look at the total picture of the horse, the total outline of the horse. And we like to see an elegant outline. This is what we want to see, round and curved shapes. This is the outline we mean by this. And this is an ideal picture of the elegant outline. Okay. The next step is the assessment of the conformation of the horse. And if anything has changed about the Friesian horse about over the last 70 years, it definitely is the conformation. First of all, when judging the conformation, I'm going to announce the breeding goal for conformation. The Friesian horse has an upward build that is functional and harmonious. The horse is athletic with good muscling. The horse stands in a rectangular model with the proportions of forehand, midsection and hindquarters reflecting 1:1:1. First of all, we examine the overall picture of the Friesian horse when we assess the conformation. What's the first impression you get from a horse? In the ideal picture, we like the Friesian horse to be of proportionate build. We like to have the horse has to have strong connections, has to have a rectangular model, an uphill frame, long lined, long legged, well muscled, with satisfactory youthfulness and a modern appearance. And I will now explain them one by one. First, the proportionate build. If you look at a horse, a Friesian horse, you can divide the horse in three parts. This is the forehand, this is the midsection, and these are the hindquarters. And if you have a proportionate build, these three parts are equal. So this is this length is equal equals this length and equals this length. And if this is the case, you have a proportionate or harmonious build. The second thing we look at is the body shape. And for the Friesian horse, we prefer a rectangular model. You compare the length of the horse's body from the chest to the backside of the seat bone to the height at withers. And if the length of the horse is larger than the height at withers, we say that the horse has a rectangular model. Most of the long-lined horses, they usually have this rectangular model. And why do we prefer this? Because a rectangular model gives more athletic capacity. It enables the horse to have more suppleness and enables the horse to do the bending better. So this is what we prefer. The opposite is the square model. As you can see, you can draw a square in this horse because the height at withers equals the length of the horse. This is the type of body shape we see with the more classical types of horses, of Friesian horses. Ik zie mijn there he is. Sorry. Okay, the direction of the body. Very important. What is the direction of the body? We compare an imaginary line throughout the body of the horse to the horizontal line. And in the left picture, you can see that the imaginary line throughout the body is downward compared to the horizontal. And actually, the average Friesian horse has a slightly downward direction of the body. This is what we prefer, a horizontal direction of the body, when the line throughout the body is equals the horizontal. And Very few horses have an upward build. But this is what we prefer. Why do we prefer this? What we like to see when we use the Friesian horse or when he is moving in the inspection ring is that the horses, normally the weight of the horse is 60% on the forehand and 40% on the hindquarters. What we like to see is that the horse can rise in the forehand. And if a horse has an upward direction of the body, it's easier for the horse to transfer the weight from the forehand to the hindquarters to generate power and to rise in the front. This is the classical type of stocky built Friesian horse, where you can see the square model again. And on the right side you see long lined horse. There's a long neck, a long back and a long croup, a long lined horse and also a rectangular model. This horse shows more athletic capacity than this horse, and you can see that the breed characteristics are the same. So the conformation has changed in the last 70 years, but we have the same requirements of the breed breed expression. Then the length of the legs in relation to the body of the horse. We like to see long-legged horses. Long leg because it's more elegant, but in use the horse has more room in its movements. What we do is we compare the length from the withers to the elbow. This is the elbow. This length compared to the length of the foreleg from the elbow to the ground. And if this leg has to be longer than this length, then we call a horse long-legged. If the horse has a short foreleg and the length from the elbow to the withers is taller, then you say you have a short-legged horse. I have two pictures for you to show it. On the left, a long-legged horse, and on the right, a short-legged horse. And I think you can imagine that this horse will move with much more room than this horse. So we discussed the overall picture of the Friesian horse. Let's go see in more detail. What we assess is the head to neck connection, the neck, the shoulders. Very important is the top line consisting of the withers, the back and the loins, and in the end the croup. What says the breeding goal? The head connection is light. And I already discussed this when I discussed breeding type. With breeding type, we looked at the elegance of the head-to-neck connection. With conformation, we look at the functionality. And what we look at is the length of the poll and the throat latch. And we prefer a long poll and enough room at the throat, so the horse has the ability to flex, to bend his head. Then the neck. The neck is long, lightly curved and rises high from the chest. The neck has a flowing connection with the withers. This is what we also discussed with breeding type. Yeah, we prefer a long neck, the length, the backside of the head to the shoulder or to the withers. That's the length of the neck. And we like to see a long neck. Here you can see how the neck emerges from the chest. In this picture, you can see that this neck emerges high from the chest, and that is favorable. I have two other pictures. On the left, high from the chest, which is what we want to see. On the right, this is not a Friesian horse, but I didn't have another example. This is a neck that rises deep or low from the chest. And you can see that this horse will have some physical limitations when you use this horse in sports. The next part. So we had the head-to-neck connection, the neck, head-to-neck connection, the neck. Now we go to the shoulder. This is the shoulder. You have to look through the skin to notice the shoulder. We look at two things. We look at the length of the shoulder and also the position of the shoulder, the conformation of the shoulder. We want the shoulder to be long and sloping. Here you can see the shoulder in the horse. Here you can see, we want this is average, we want the shoulder to be sloping of about 45 degrees with the horizontal line. This is a steep shoulder, and as you can see, the horse is also standing under. That goes together quite often. The shoulder is part of the foreleg of the horse, with the upper arm, the elbow, the underarm, the foreknee, the cannon, the fetlock joint, and the pasterns. This is the foreleg. And the foreleg determines the room the foreleg can make to the front. We prefer a sloping shoulder, and the reason why is that it determines, together with the withers, the saddle fit. And with a sloping shoulder, you have a good saddle fit and also a good position of the rider. Then, together with the direction of the body, the most important part of the conformation, the top line. The withers are well developed and flow smoothly through the to the back. The back is strong with a flowing connection to the loins. The loins are strong and wide with a flowing connection to the croup. So if we talk about the top line, when assessing the conformation of the Friesian horse, we talk about the withers, the back, and the loins here. We want to have a flowing line, and we want them to be well muscled. The top line plays an important role in transferring power generated in the hindquarters to the rest of the horse's body. So it's very important. Let's go in detail. First, the withers. They have to be well developed and flow smoothly through the back. The withers, they are shaped by the spinous processes of the first thoracic vertebrae. And together with the shoulder, they are important for the saddle fit. Here you can see very low withers. And what is expected if you put a saddle on this horse is that it's going to slide to the left and to the right. Two examples for you. Here are very well developed withers. We don't like, it's not a flowing connection here. This is what we don't like, but the withers are very well developed. So the saddle will fit perfect. And these are flat withers, and here you can expect sliding of the saddle. The second part of the top line, the back. The back is strong with a flowing connection to the loins. The back. From the withers to the loins. This is the back of the horse. We like the back to be strong, well muscled, with a flowing connection to withers and loins, and the length has to be in proportion with the forehand and the midsection. The proportionate build, where the three parts equal each other. So we don't want a very long back. When we look at the back, we look at the length of the back and the shape of the back. First, the shape of the back. A back can be tight and can be weak. If a back is very tight, you have less suppleness in the movement. That is expected. On the other hand, when you have a very weak back, it's not good for the sustainability of a horse. And also for the functionality, you have insufficient supporting power with a weak back. This is what we like to see. And actually, we rather see a bit a tight back than a weak back. Now, here you can see an example from of a tight back that is really too tight. It's called a roach back. It can be that the horse is in pain or has a medical condition, but it's not. Yeah, if a horse has a back like this, it will not be accepted in the stud book. Here we have a horse with a very long back and also no flowing strong connections. So what is expected in movement is that the horse is not able to move in the right way in connection. The same picture here with a sunken back. And this is the opposite, a very tight back. The last part of the top line, the loins. They have to be strong and wide with a flowing connection to the group. Most of the people find it very difficult to assess where the loins are. The loins are the only bone structure between the hindquarters and the midsection and forehand of a horse. These are the loins, the bones of the loins. And you need, this is the only bone structure, so you need a lot of muscles here to make a strong connection. Because the loins, they have a function as a bridge. They have to, the power that is generated in the hindquarters has to be transferred to the rest of the horse's body. And the loins play an important role in this, as a bridge. You can also imagine in this picture, you can see that this horse has very weak loins. And when you have weak loins, you can expect that the movement seems to sort of break in the loins. So that is not favorable. Here you can see the tight loins and here again weak loins. If you see this in the conformation, probably the score for conformation will not be sufficient because of the importance of this bridge function for the horse. And the last part of the conformation, the croup. The croup is long and lightly sloping, so we look at the length of the croup and the position of the croup. Here you can see a good croup of a horse. This is the position of and also the length of the croup. We want it to be lightly sloping and well muscled. How do we assess the length of the croup? We look at the anatomical length from the front side of the hip bone here to the back side of the seat bone. This is the anatomical length and this is what we assess when we talk about croup length. Other stud books, they call the croup length the horizontal line. So this is the croup length. We don't do that because a sloping croup is always short in this case. So we prefer the anatomical length, hip bone to seat bone. Okay, the length of the croup is important for the amount of power that can be generated. The longer the croup, the more power can be generated. And this is the principle, the law of the lever. Here you can see a long croup, and here you can see a short croup. So this horse can generate more power than this horse. That is to be expected. If you look at the conformation, we like to see a kind of straight croup. This is unfavorable, a very sloping croup. It affects the horse's weight-carrying capacity. We want a slightly sloping croup, allowing tilting of the pelvis so that the horse can bring the hind legs further under the body and rise in the front. Here you can see two examples of very sloping croups. Very, very sloping and I think not acceptable for us. Okay. Now we have the third aspect, also part of the exterior of the horse, the legwork. The legs are the horse's foundation, and the foundation is very important. It carries the rest of the horse, like the foundation of a building. We assess those features of the legs that serve correct movement and sustainability, the quality of leg work, leg defects, the stance of the legs, and the feet. We assess leg work when the horse is standing in front of us in halt, except from the correctness of the foreleg, which is assessed in the walk. So, the breeding goal, leg work. In general, the forelegs and hind legs have correct conformation and stance. The joints are clean and dry. When we look at the forelegs, we want them Seen from the front and the side, the stance of the forelegs is vertical with the feet one hoof width apart, and the forearm and cannon are long. The hind leg, seen from the side, the hind leg shows the optimum angle, the hock joint is dry, hard and well developed, and seen from behind, the stance of the hind legs is parallel. Fetlocks and pasterns, seen from the side, the fetlocks are overly shaped and dry, the pasterns have satisfactory length and optimum stance. And in the end, the feet are of generous size, well shaped and a symmetrical pair. First of all, the quality of leg work. Here we look at the dry quality of the legs. We like to see the contours of the joints and the tendons clearly. And then we talk about hard or dry leg work, like in this picture here. The opposite is puffy leg work, when you have fluid between the skin and the bone. Then you talk about puffy leg work. We also look at leg defects when we inspect a horse, when we assess a horse, and I show you some of them. Some of them are restrictive for studbook acceptance, and some of them are just imperfections. If they don't have any influence on the movement, they are just imperfections and are not taken into account. Notice that judges are not vets, they don't make diagnoses in the ring. The first picture here, you can see the first two pictures actually. You can see box Bevin, and which is an inflammation of the bursa of the hock joint with overfilling of the joint. This is not acceptable for stud book, for taken into the stud book. Here you can see bone Bevin, a hard swelling on the lower inner side of the hock joint, also not acceptable. This is a splint. This is just an imperfection. It's a bony lump on the cannon bone, mostly caused by external trauma. This is a capped hock, a swollen bursa on the hock caused by trauma, also an imperfection. So if a horse shows this in the inspection ring, it doesn't have to be a problem. Of course, we don't see it. It's not favorable, but we don't take this into account. And in this picture, this last picture, you can see tight in cannon, when the transition from the cannon into the hock joint is too acute. Then, very important, the leg stances. Any deviation in stances of the leg work will cause a deviation in movement and uneven strain with an increased risk of wear. So we want correct leg stances. We judge leg conformation from the front, in profile and from behind, and I will briefly discuss the most common defects. As we hear, as seen from the side, the foreleg must have perpendicular stance in which the forearm, the foreknee and the cannon must be in line with each other. So this is a correct stance of the foreleg. When the foreknee is bending a bit forward, we call it buck-kneed. And when the foreknee is bending a bit backwards, we call it calf-kneed. And as you can imagine, is that these deviations, they cause disproportionate pressure on the foreknee and the lower leg. And especially tendons and ligaments, they suffer from the strain with an increased risk of injuries and wear. As seen from the front, this is what we normally judge in walk, but these pictures are of horses that are in halt. This is a picture where you, what we call toeing out. As you can see, the feet of the forelegs, they have a deviation outwards from the fetlock. So this is called toeing out. With toeing in, there's a deviation from the fetlocks inwards, from the fetlock inwards. So this is toeing in, this is toeing out. And this affects the movement and the stability in movement, as you can see in the next slide. With the current stance of the legs, you have the forelegs in straight lines. When a horse is toeing out, It leads to a dishing gait with a fair chance of interfering. The horse lifts his feet with an inward swing followed by an outward swing when he puts the feet down. And toeing in leads to a winching gait, where the horse lifts his foot with an outward swing followed by an inward swing when putting it down. So this is toeing in, toeing out, and this is toeing in. And you can imagine that it crosses, it has a higher risk of wear when you don't have a correct stance of the front legs. We go to the hind leg. This is the correct hind leg, as seen from the side. Actually, we want a perpendicular line through the buttocks, the bed of the buttock, the hock, and the fetlock. This picture is not correct, actually, because this has to be a straight line, and it isn't. So, actually, if we want to put a line here through the buttock and the hock, and the cannon bone has to be straight. So, this is not a perfectly correct picture of the hind leg. Furthermore, what's important is the angle in the hock joint. It has to be at least about 150 degrees. The angle between the gaskin and the cannon bone, this is the hock joint, and this angle has to be 150 degrees. If the angle is smaller than 145 degrees, we call the hind leg sickle hocked. And sickle hocked is also called bowed hind leg. It causes more pressure on the hock joint. And furthermore, the hind leg can generate less power. So this is not what we prefer. But we also don't prefer a straight hind leg, like here, where the angle is larger than 155 degrees. This puts a lot of pressure on the fetlock joint. And when the horses become older, you have a lot of problems here in the pasterns. And a straight hind leg shows less suppleness too. Two examples. Here a sickle-hocked hind leg with a small angle in the hock joint. And here a very straight hind leg, almost 180 degrees. It's almost a perpendicular line. So with a sickle-hocked hind leg, you have more pressure on the hock joints and the hind leg can generate less power. And with a straight hind leg, you have less suppleness and also a lot of wear in the fetlock joint. Then, the hind legs seen from behind. Correct is when both hind legs are parallel to each other. Cow-hocked stance is a common defect, very common defect. There's not enough space between the hocks. So the hocks are turned a bit inwards and the knees point a bit outward. You don't see it on the picture. It's not good for the stability and you have an increased risk of wear and less power, especially in combination with a sickle-hocked hind leg. The opposite way is a bow-legged hind leg. And this is an indication of weak hindquarters. We don't see this a lot. The cow-hocked hind leg we see a lot. Then the pastern. The pastern's function is the shock absorber of the horse. And they need to have a correct stance and satisfactory length. We look at the angle of the pasterns with the horizontal. On the left, can see front legs and you see sloping pasterns and they generate a lot of spring, but also increases the strain on the tendons. On the right, you see hind legs with very steep or upright pasterns. And here you have insufficient shock absorption during movement. The last part of the legwork are the feet. And the breeding call states that the feet are of generous size, well-shaped and a symmetrical pair. What you can see here on the picture is two hooves that are not the same. This one is smaller and more narrow, and this one is more wide and larger. We definitely don't want to see this because it will have consequences for the whole leg of the horse and increases a higher risk of increases the risk of wear. Okay, we discussed the exterior, the breeding type, the conformation and the legwork. The other part of the assessment of the Friesian horse is judging the movement. Horses that largely meet the requirements of the breeding goal in relation to the exterior, you can expect it to have more talent in use. Conformation also determines the horse's potential in movement, but mentality also plays an important role. The general requirements for the movement. Oh no, first I will explain the breeding goal. And the movement is part of the breeding goal for sport aptitude. In general, we like to have a Friesian horse that is a versatile utility horse, must have a good movement mechanism, a functional exterior, stamina, willingness to work, and cooperative mentality. In terms of sport, the goal is a Friesian horse that is competitive at elementary and subtop levels and that progresses to the highest level. We use the Friesian horse in the dressage under the saddle, in the driving dressage, the combined driving, and in harness sports. And here's the part that says something about the movement of the Friesian horse. The paces are regular and rhythmic. The horses move in an uphill outline with engagement from the hindquarters and lots of balance and use of the body. So in the next slide, I will discuss the general requirements for the movement. So this applies for both the walk and the trot and the canter. First of all, the gait has to be correct. And what do we mean by that? We mean by that the legs are placed forward in the same track. The second thing that's very important is tact and rhythm. The soundness of the horse's movement. For walk, we would like to see a 4-beat gait, for trot, a 2-beat gait, and for canter, a 3-beat gait. The scope is the length of the strides. The power is the degree of push-up from the ground with the hind legs. Balance is the combination of body posture and the degree of self-carriage achieved by the hind leg. Use of the body is the degree in which the movement swings elastically through the body, also called suppleness. Shoulder freedom, this means that the shoulder blade can move freely along the body. Capacity for transitions, very important, whether the horse can be ridden forward and condensed back again, and in hand also go forward and come back again. And the last thing is the forward going attitude. The willingness of the horse to go forward and to perform. And altogether, this determines the athletic capacity of the Friesian horse. We will discuss the movement in short in this short webinar, because this webinar is only an introduction to all the characteristics. The first gait we want to discuss is the walk. The walk displays a sound four-tack rhythm. Seen from front and back, the legs are placed forward in a straight line in walk. The hind leg is placed well forward under the body with good activity, and the foreleg is generously placed forward. And what's very important is that the movement must flow through the horse's whole body. As you can see, the walk is a 4-beat gait and has no moment of suspension. It's very important that the horse moves forward rather than upward. You can see a picture. In the walk, the hind leg has to send away the front leg. Then we go to the second gait, the trot. The breeding goal states that the trot has a regular 2-beat rhythm. The hind leg is placed forward under the body with power and good reach, so that the horse develops self-carriage. The hind leg shows good bend in the hock, and the foreleg shows knee action and is generously placed forward. The horse moves in an uphill outline, showing suppleness, balance and a satisfactory moment of suspension. So this, in the trot, we do have a moment of suspension. Seen from the front and back, the legs must be played forward in a straight line. So this is the correctness. So all the general requirements you see back in the breeding goal again. The most important part of the trot is the way the hind leg moves. As you can see here, this is the perpendicular line. This is the carrying phase in the trot, the green line, and this is the propelling phase, the red line. What we want to see is a carrying trot in which you have a larger carrying phase than a propelling phase. And also the gas can becomes further in a vertical position, so the horse places its hind leg far under the body. This is what we call a carrying trot. The opposite is a horse that moves more behind the body with a short carrying phase and a long propelling phase. This is what we call a pushing trot. This is what we prefer. And this is how you see it when we use the horse. This is a very young horse, a three-year-old horse, but you can see the position of the casking is more than vertical. The horse places has a long carrying phase and a shorter propelling phase. And this is a very nice picture of a self-carrying trot. This is the opposite. This horse doesn't move in an uphill outline. Actually, it dives towards the ground, stays high in the croup, and the movement of the hind legs is behind the body instead of under the body. Then the last gait, the canter, has a regular three-beat rhythm. In canter, the horse moves with active and roomy strides, a forward-reaching foreleg and a carrying hind leg. The canter is uphill with a good moment of suspension, suppleness and balance. Now, as you all know, with the inspections in hand, we only judge the walk and the trot. The canter we only access in the aptitude tests, like the IBOP and ABFP tests. And during the stallion selections, when the stallions move freely in the cage, and during the presentation days. So we don't assess the canter in hand. Okay. We discussed the breeding type, the conformation, the legwork and the movement. Now the last part, which we don't judge in the inspection ring, but it's very important to mention it tonight, of today, the character. The breeding goal says something about the character, says something about the reliability. The Friesian horse is a level-headed, honest horse with easy contact manners. And it says something about the trainability. The Friesian horse is intelligent, has a cooperative attitude, is therefore easy to train. The Friesian horse possesses perseverance and a good work ethos. It's very important to know the character of your mare and take this into account for your stallion choice. If your mare is, for example, phlegmatic in use, a breeder should prefer a stallion with more willingness to work. There's a lot of information about the character of the studbook stallions in their reports on the KFPS website. So the character is also a thing you have to take into account when you want to breed your mare. Okay, if you're not capable of assessing your mare yourself, you can always rely on the information the KFPS generated at studbook acceptance. Each horse that is accepted in the studbook has a linear scoring form. And you can see here, this is called the upper bar. It states 27 characteristics. These are characteristics of the breeding type, characteristics of the conformation, characteristics of the legwork, the walk and the trot. The score is filled in here. And the scores in the gray areas reflect the breeding goal. So here you can see the strong and less strong points of your mare. The upper bar, there we give scores for breeding type, conformation, legwork, walk and trot. And this also gives you information about the qualities of your mare. We give scores, but the elements of the movement count twice in relation to the elements of the conformation. So the walk and trot count twice. How can you interpret the scores we give? We give scores between 4 and 9. And when a horse scores a 9, It's very good, and actually, it's the ideal picture we like to see. When a horse gets a 4, it's not acceptable for stud book acceptance. So, if your horse has like 6 on breeding type, 7 on conformation, and 6 on legwork, and 8 on walk, and 9 on trot, you can see that the movement is close to the breeding goal, but that you can improve the conformation of the exterior of the horse by choosing a stallion that improves that part. There was another question in this webinar: how can I make progress in my breeding? This of course depends very much on what kind of mare you have and also what your own breeding goal is. But in general, when we look at the breeding now, I think we can improve the following things. The first one is that we can improve the athletic capacity of the Friesian horse, and then especially the suppleness of the horse. Furthermore, sustainability is very important, so always think of a correct foundation for your horse. In the movement, we have the canter has improved the last 30 years very much. So, and you can train the trot. So what's important in breeding is that you pay attention to the walk of your mare and also to the walk of the offspring of your mare. And last but not least, I already discussed this here, the character and how you take into account the character of your mare when you choose a stallion for the mare. Okay, this was in a nutshell the theory of judging the Friesian horse. If you want to know more, you can order a book, Judging the Friesian Horse, which is available in Dutch, of course, in English, in German, and in Spanish. Furthermore, I want to thank you for attending this webinar. And if you have any questions, you can send an email to mail@kfbs.nl. Thank you very much.